A Truly Mysterious, The Invisible Island by Ron Roy. Chapter 1. Donald David Duncan, known as Dink to his friends, answered the telephone. Duncan residence, Dink speaking. Get over here, Josh Pinto yelled. Dink jerked the phone away from his ear. Why? He asked. My mom says we can have a picnic on Squall Island, Josh said. She made us lunch. It was a steaming hot July day. Splashing around in the Indian River will feel great, thought Jack, Dink. Okay, let me tell my mom and pick up Bruce Rose. We'll be right over. Dink ran up the stairs to his parents' room. His mother was sitting at her sewing machine, mending a pair of Dink's jeans. Hey, Mom, me and Josh and Rich Rose are going to the river for a picnic, okay? Dink asked. Okay, but you kids stay together, she said. Thanks, Mom. Dink pulled on old shorts and his grubby Snickers. Before he left, he fed Loretta his guinea pig. Dink heard her squeak happily as he ran back down the stairs. Dink hurried over to Rich Rose's house. Rich Rose's cat, Tiger, was nursing her kittens on the front step. Dink carefully stepped around them, then rang the bell. The door opened. Rich Rose's little brother, Nate, stood in the doorway. He had a cookie in each hand and another in his mouth. Hi, Nady, Dink said. Is your sister here?
She'll give a muppy, Nate said, drew his cookie.
Dink blinked at Nate. Huh? Rich Rose appeared next to Nate. Hi, Dink. What's going on? She said. Rich Rose Hathaway liked to dress all in one color. Today, she wore blue shorts, a blue t-shirt, and blue sneakers. Her springy black curls were held in place by a blue headband. Josh wants to go to Squall Island for a picnic, Dink said. Rich Rose grinned. Great. She leaned back into the house. See you later, Mom. I'm going on a picnic with the guys. Then she bent down and wiped cookie crumbs from her brother's lips. Nady, go stay with Mommy, okay? I'll bring you back a magic stone. Nate grinned and ran back into the house. Rich Rose pulled the door shut. Then she and Dink cut through her backyard and crossed Eagle Lane. A few minutes later, they were at Josh's house. Josh was in his front yard, holding a garden hose. His little twin brothers, Brian and Bradley, were screaming and racing through the water. Hi, Josh said. When he saw Dink and Rich Rose, he shot off the water. Gotta go, he told Brian and Bradley. Be good boys and don't leave the yard. Josh grabbed his backpack off the porch. Hope you guys hungry, he said. Mom packed a lot of food. That should last you about 3 minutes, Dink said, grinning. The kid hiked through the field behind Josh's house. Then they crossed River Road and walked to the bank of the Indian River. The river flowed slowly, rippling over a few large rocks. In most places, the water was shallow enough to wade across. Trees and shrubbery grew along the banks. Birds and squirrels chattered in the greenery. The kid walked along the river, slapping at mosquitoes. They stopped when they saw Skull Island, the small island set in the middle of the river. It was mostly sand, shrubs, and rocks. No tree grew there, and no animals made the island their home, but the kids loved the sandy beach and clean, shallow water. They waded in, wearing their Snickers. Soon they were up to their knees. Boy, this feels good, Dink said as the cool water climbed his sweaty legs. He kicked water at Josh and Rich Rose. They splashed him back, and pretty soon all three were soaked. A few minutes later, they flopped down on the island's small beach. Dink took off his Snickers and wiggled his toes in the warm sand. Let's eat, Josh said. He opened his backpack and brought out plastic bags holding sandwiches, slices of watermelon, and cookies. I wonder what it will be like to be stranded on an island, he said. Dink chewed a sandwich. Josh, we couldn't get stranded out here. All we have to do is wade back to shore. Josh had a faraway look in his eyes. Yeah, but what if pirates buried treasure here, he said. He dug a hole in the sand with his heel. We could be sitting over a chest filled with gold. I don't think there were any pirates in Connecticut, Rich Rose pointed out. Why not? Josh asked. He gestured toward the vine-covered boulders in the center of the island. This world's be a perfect place for a pirate hideout. Ahoy, mate, Bing said. Retro stood up. I want to explore, she said. She walked toward the water. I promised Nate I'll bring him a magic stone. What's a magic stone? Bing asked. He followed her to the water's edge. This is, Retro held up a smooth, pure white pebble. What makes it magic? Nate has a bunch of these in his room, Rifru said. My parents told him if he kept his room neat, the stones will turn into nickels. Josh joined Dink and Rifru. He handed each of them a cookie. And Nate believed them? Rifru grinned. When Nate cleans his room, Mom sneaks in and takes one of the stones. She leaves a nickel in its place. The kids diverted walking along the shore. The sun felt hot on Ding's back, so he took off his shirt. Hey guys, look, Josh yelled. He was standing over a footprint. Somebody else has been here. He grinned at Ding and Rifros. Maybe it was Blackbeard. Ding stepped into the footprint. It was twice as big as his foot. I don't know about Blackbeard, he said, but whoever this was has really big feet. Look, here's another one, Rifro said, and another. The kid followed the footprint away from the water. They led toward the boulders and at the center of the island. The footprint stopped suddenly in front of a squat, vine-covered boulder. That's funny, Ding said. What'd a guy do, jump over these rocks? Maybe he walked around them, Joshua said. Ding and Josh began to circle the boulder slowly, looking for more footprints. Rifru started walking in the other direction. Suddenly, Ding heard her yell, Hey guys, come over here, quick! Ding and Josh ran back the way they come. Look, Rifru said, pointing down between her feet. Something green was poking out of the sand. What is it? Josh asked. Money! Rifru yelled. Chapter 2. A $10 bill, Josh said, grabbing the bill and holding it up. Wrong, Ding said, plucking it out of Josh's finger. Count the zeros. Josh's mouth fell open. Red Rose's blue eyes got huge. Ding was holding $100 bill. $100? Josh squeaked. He reached for the bill, but Ding quickly handed the money to Red Rose. She found it, he said. But who lost it? Red Rose asked. Shoving the bill into a pocket, Ding pointed to the footprint in the sand. Maybe he did. The kid stared at the footprint. Maybe he lost more, Josh said. Let's search. The kid separated. With their eyes on the ground, they climbed over boulders and picked under bushes. They found plenty of poison ivy, but no more $100 bills. Hey guys, look at this, Ding called from near the water's edge. Josh and Ruth Rose ran to where he was standing. Ding pointed to a long patch of sand that was perfectly smooth. It looked as if someone had scraped a boat over the sand, flattering all the little bumps. I'll bet somebody came out here with a rowboat, Ruth Rose said. This must be where they dragged it up on the beach. I wonder if the same person who brought the boat made those footprints, Ding said, pulling his t-shirt back on. And dropped that $100 bill, said Josh. Red Rose patted her pocket. I don't know, but we have to try to find him. Why, Josh said, grinning. Think of what we could buy with that money. Split three ways, of course. Forget it, Josh, Red Rose said. The money's in ours. We have to return it. To who? To whoever lost it, Ding said. And how are we supposed to find the guy? Josh asked. The kid sat in the sand and thought. I know, Rifro said. We can go to Ron's bait shop. Maybe Mr. P knows who was out here. Good idea, Ding said. Boy, said Josh, getting to his feet. You guys sure want to get rid of that money fast. How will you feel if you lost a $100 bill? Rifro asked Josh. He grinned. Trust me, if I ever got one, I never lose it. Anyway, let's eat the watermelon my mom packed. Those cookies made my mouth dry. They walked back to Josh's pack and slurped on sweet, juicy chunks of watermelon. They split the seed at each other as they packed up. Josh shrugged into his backpack. Well, if we have to return the money, maybe we'll get our names in the paper, he said. He scratched his ankles. Maybe we'll get a reward. Rose grinned. Josh, the only thing you're going to get is poison ivy. Chapter 3. The kids waded back into the river. A few minutes later, they were squishing their way up River Road to Ron's bait shop. Ron Pankowski lived in an old house next to the river. On the ground floor, he sold bait, boating supplies and groceries. He also repaired and painted boats and fixed boat motors. The kid trudged down a dusty driveway to the house. Several small boats were lined up in Mr. Pinkowski's big yard along the riverbank. A striped cat slept on the back step. Out the back door trailed a long orange extension cord. The kid followed the cord around the side of the house. They spotted Mr. Pankowski under a shady tree, standing a boat bottom. "Hi, Mr. P," Dink said. Ron Pankowski switched off the electric sender. He was tall and sandy, haired, and sported a curly beard and ruby mustache.
"Well, hi, kids. What you're up to today?" he asked.
Smiling, Riff Rose pulled a $100 bill out of her pocket. "I just found this on Squall Island," she said.
"Goodness," Ron said. "Aren't you a lucky gal?"
"We saw some marks in the sand from a boat," Dink said.
"And some footprints too," Josh added.
"Really big ones."
"We think whoever was out there might have lost the money," Riff Rose said.
"Wonder who it could be."
Ron leaned against the boat and tugged on his beard.
"Not many folks go out there. The poison ivy grows something fierce in all that sand."
"Yeah, and I think I walk right through some," Josh said, scratching his leg.
Ron smiled. "All I have to do is look at the stuff and I swell up like a balloon," he said.
"Could we have a note here about the money?" Riff Rose asked.
"Good idea, Riff Rose. I'll stick it up near my bait tanks."
The kid followed Ron into his bait shop, where he handed Riff Rose a pencil and pad. She thought for a minute, then wrote, "If you lost money on Squall Island, call 555-9916.
"Shouldn't you say how much you found?" Josh asked.
Riff Rose shook her head. "If I write that right amount, anyone could call and claim it, even if they didn't lose it." Ron tagged Riff Rose's note to a small bulletin board.
"Lots of people will see it here," he said.
"Thanks, Mr. P," Riff Rose said. "I hope whoever lost the money sees the note."
Ron grinned. "Wish it was me."
The kid laughed. They said goodbye and headed for Dog Walkway.
"So what you're gonna do with the money?"
John asked Riff Rose. "I'll be glad to hold on to it for you." Riff Rose shook her head. "Nope, I'm giving it to Officer Fallon. It'll be safe at the police station."
Josh scratched his arm. "Let's stop at Ellie's on the way. Maybe an ice cream cone will help me forget about this losy poison ivy."
The kids crossed the elementary school white lawn and hiked through down the main street. As they opened the door to Ellie's diner, cool air washed over them. After they ordered cones, Riff Rose asked Ellie if she knew anyone who had lost money on Squall Island.
"Someone with really huge feet," Dink added.
Ellie shook her head. "Hon, I don't even know anyone who goes out there. I heard it covered with poison ivy." She noticed Josh scratching. "Looks like someone else is covered with this stuff." The kid thanked Ellie and laughed. They worked on their cones on the way to the police station.
"I can't believe we're gonna just give away $100, Josh said.
"If I get a reward," Riff Rose said, "I'll split it with you guys."
Josh grinned. "Now you're talking."
They found Officer Fallon sitting at his desk. He was watching his computer screen and sipping a glass of lemonade.
"Howdy," he said, as the kid tripped in. "What can I do for you?"
"Look at this," Riff Rose said. She placed a $100 bill on his desk.
Officer Fallon picked up the bill and examined it. "Where did this come from?" he asked.
"Riff Rose found it on Squall Island," Josh told him. "We were out there having a picnic, and it wasn't in the sand."
"I'm trying to find out who lost it," Riff Rose said. "Mr. Pinkowski let me put a note on his bulletin board. I left my phone number."
"This bill could be lost a long time ago," Officer Fallon said. "Not many folks go to Squall Island." He grinned at Riff Rose. "If no one claims it, the money is yours to keep."
"Really?" Riff Rose said. "Cool." Officer Fallon put the bill in an envelope and sealed it. He wrote the date and Riff Rose's name on the outside.
"I'll put this in our safe," he said. "If it's still here in 30 days, I'll let you know."
The kid thanked Officer Fallon and left. "Gee, Riff Rose," Josh said as they waited for the light on Main Street.
"Will you split the 103 ways if you get to keep it?"
"I might," she said, "if you're extra nice to me."
"I'm always nice to you," Dink whispered something in Riff Rose's ear.
"Okay, prove you're nice," she told Josh. "Come over tomorrow and mow my lawn.
Josh
Josh laughed. I have a better idea. Let's go back to the island and look for more money.
Josh, we already did, and there wasn't any, the thing said.
But we never found where the footprint ended, Josh argued. I'll bet if we do, we'll find buried treasure.
What about the poison ivy? Rose reminded him.
Josh scratched his neck.
So, what a little poison ivy, he said. I'm going back to Squall Island tomorrow and I'm bringing a shovel. He grinned at his friends. You coming with me or do I keep the treasure all to myself?
Chapter 4. Think yawn and look out at the kitchen window the next morning. Fog, he muttered. He finished his cereal and put the bowl in the sink. Just then the doorbell rang. It was Josh, standing on the porch holding a shovel. You ready to go? He asked. It's so foggy, Ding said, looking over Josh's shoulder. I can hardly see across the street. We won't find the island, let alone a treasure. If there's more money out there, I'll find it, Josh said, stretching his ankle. Let's get Rich Rose.
I'm already here, Rose said, appearing out of the fog.
When she saw Josh scratching, she said, You better put something on that poison ivy, Joshua.
My mom said the same thing, Josh said. He scratched his arm. She gave me more money to buy more Salmin lotion. Now let's get going.
Balancing the shovel over one shoulder, Josh led his friend through Rose's backyard and across Meadow Road. The tall, dewy grass on the other side soaked their sneakers and legs. Near the river, the fog was even thicker. It hung the tree branches like miniature clouds. The kids' faces and hair were wet.
I can't even see the river, Dink muttered.
It's right here, Josh said, splashing the water with his shovel.
Yeah, but where's the island? Rose asked.
The kid gazed out to where they thought Squall Island should be. All they could see was more fog. One patch looked a little darker than the rest.
That must be it, Josh said, stepping into the water. Come on, guys, I can almost smell the money.
Like a hound dog, Ding muttered. The river was quiet. No birds sang. The kid like splashing through the water made the only sound. Ding began to imagine some fog monster creeping towards him. It had slimy green tentacles and 6-inch long teeth. Ding was glad when the water became shallower. Suddenly, his foot struck dry land. They were on Squall Island again. The kid stopped and looked around. Whips of fog hung over everything. Ding could barely make out of the mound of boulders in the center of the island. He remembered yesterday's sun on his back and shivered.
This place is creepy in the fog, Rizro said. I hope the sun comes out soon.
Okay, Joshua, Ding said. You got us out here. Now what?
Josh dropped to his hands and knees. Help me find the big footprints again, he said.
The kid finally quickly found the print and followed them to the squat, vine-covered boulder.
So, where Bigfoot comes go from here? Josh muttered.
It looks like the guy walked into the big rock, Ding said.
Maybe he climbed over it, Rizro said.
Josh poked his shovel into the poison ivy vines covering the boulder. The shovel clinks against stone. Josh tried another spot. This time the shovel went straight in.
Hey guys, Josh said, I think I found something.
Using the shovel to keep the vines back, Josh peered into a dark space.
There's two boulders here, he said.
And look, Rishro said, a little path goes right between them.
The path was hidden, covered with poison ivy leaves and vines.
He must have gone through there, Ding said.
But it's all poison ivy, Rishro said.
Wait a sec, Josh said. He chomped at the poison ivy with his shovel until he had cleared a passage.
Just be careful, he said.
Single file, the kid walked down the narrow path. Enormous boulders loomed over them on each side. Soon they came to a small, sandy clearing in the middle of the rocks. The rocks were thick with poison ivy. The dew-covered leaves were dull green in the fog.
I feel like I'm in some jungle, Rifro said.
More print, Josh said, dropping down on his knees. Ding got down next to Josh.
They look like they're from the same guy, Ding said, but there are so many, and they walk all over each other.
Now what, Josh? Rizro said.
Now we search for treasure, Josh said. We'll take turns and dig all over this place.
They began digging hole after hole. Rizro found a rusty nail, but no treasure. Soon the kids were sweaty and covered with sand.
Josh started filling the holes back and so no one will step in them. Thing flopped down against one of the boulders.
Watch out!
Rose yelled. Thing jumped away from the rock. Something was sticking him through his shirt.
Ouch! What's poking me?
He asked. He turned around so Josh and Rose could see his back. Can you see anything?
Josh grinned. Just a hunk of poison ivy, he said.
Stop grinning and get it off me,
Thing yelled. I'll get it,
Rose said. She rushed at the twig into the shovel handle. Is it gone? Thing asked, trying to see over his shoulder.
This is amazing, Rose said. Look, Josh.
I don't believe it, Josh said.
What's amazing, Thing cried. What are guys doing back there?
He was already feeling itchy.
This poison ivy is fake,
Rose said. Huh? Thing turned around. Rose handed him a green sprig. The leaf were plastic and the stem was made of brown wire.
I don't get it, Thing said.
Why won't anyone?
This is too weird, Josh said.
He placed the shovel blade between the boulder and the fake poison ivy. Then he twisted the shovel and pressed off a section of vines. It came away from the face of the boulder and the sheet and fell flat on the ground.
The whole rock is covered with plastic poison ivy,
Rose said, tied to a wooden frame.
Forget that, George said. Look what was under this stuff.
The boulder wasn't a boulder at all. The kids were staring at a large, square, cement slab.
Chapter 5.
What is it? Think and Rose asked at the same time.
It looks like a salmon refrigerator, Josh said.
Rose laughed. Gee, Josh, I wonder if there's food in it.
Very funny. Josh climbed up on some smaller rocks and hoisted himself to the top of the slab.
It fled up here too, he said.
This thing is a big salmon box.
Is this front part a door?
Rose asked. She poked the flap. Let's slap with the shovel. Thing ran with his fingers along the side.
I can't find any hints, he said.
He tugged at it, but it didn't budge.
Maybe there's a secret lock somewhere,
Rose suggested.
She began digging around the bottom of the slab. All she found was stones and poison ivy root.
Ouch, Josh said, still on top. There's something sharp up here.
He poked his head over the top. Climb up here, guys. I think I found the key to this thing.
Thing and Rose scrambled up next to Josh.
Look at this, Josh said. He pointed to a metal rod poking out of the cement.
Try pulling on it, Thing suggested.
Josh grabbed the rod and yanked.
Doesn't come out, he muttered.
Does it wiggle back and forth? Rose asked. She put her foot against the rod and shoved. It still didn't budge.
Well, it has to do something, Thing said.
He climbed down off the cement box, grabbed the shovel, and handed it up to Josh.
Try hitting it with that,
he said. Josh held the shovel over his head, braced himself, and gave the rod a good smack. Suddenly, they heard a scratching noise, like fingernails on a chalkboard.
Whoa, that did it, Thing yelled, jumping back.
It's moving! The cement door swung open, revealing a damp, musty closet. Thing took a step forward, then stopped. His jaw dropped.
What's in there? Josh asked, staring down at Thing.
Thing didn't answer.
Thing?
Rose said.
What's going on?
Thing gulped and tried to speak.
Muh.
What the heck is muh?
Josh said.
Mud? Mummies? Muffins?
Thing could barely breathe, let alone talk.
Money!
He finally said. Chapter 6. Josh and Rose scrambled down and stared into the opening. Inside, it was like a vault. Metal shelves had been attached to the salmon walls with thick bolts, and every shelf had money. Stacks of green bills were piled one on top of another. Everywhere Dink looked, he saw white and red of money.
There must be millions of dollars
in here, Josh said. He closed his eyes. I think I'm gonna throw up.
But whose money is it? Rose said. Who put it here?
Thing stepped inside the vault. On the bottom shelves were cardboard boxes with happy heart dog food written on the side.
Dog food? He said.
Josh and Rose crowded into the vault. Rose peeked into two of the boxes.
More money, she said.
Suddenly, Thing looked back over his shoulder. Shh, he whispered. I think I heard something. The kids stood perfectly still and listened. There it is again, Ding said. A muffled squeaking sound came through the fog. Then there was a silence. Then another squeak. Dingle froze into the spot. It's coming closer, he whispered. Maybe it's a pirate, Josh said.
It could be the guy with big feet, said Rose. Maybe this is his treasure.
Let's get out of here, Ding said.
Help me close with this thing.
The kids swung the cement door shut. Josh grabbed his shovel while Ding and Rose lifted the plastic poison ivy back into place. Now the cement safe was hidden again. Ding quickly led the way back through the boulders to the water. On the narrow beach, they stood in the fog and listened. Ding heard the squeaking sound again, then soft thud, then silent. Slowly, a small boat drifted out of the fog. A large, dark figure sat hunched in the stern. Ding didn't dare move or say anything. It looked as if the figure was staring at them. After what seemed like a year, the figure began to row again away. Ding heard the oars squeak as the boat vanished back into the fog.
Who was that? Josh croaked.
I don't know, Ding said.
Whoever it was, let's get off this island, Rishro said.
The kid quietly stepped into the shallow water, trying not to splash. They waded to shore. Ding kept watch for the boat and its silent passenger, but he couldn't see anything through the fog. Behind them, Squall Island became invisible once more. 10 minutes later, they flung open the door to Officer Fallon's office. Officer Fallon looked up from his computer.
What's wrong, kids? You look like you're seeing a ghost.
He stared at their soggy sneakers, and you're all wet.
We found more money, Rishro said. Millions of dollars.
Officer Fallon raised one eyebrow.
Really?
We did,
Josh said. Okay, sit down and talk to me, Officer Fallon said, switching off his computer. The kid perched on the edges of their chairs.
We went back to the island, Ding explained, and found a cement face safe. It had stacks of money in it. They told Officer Fallon about the secret path, the plastic poison ivy, and the hidden cement vault.
Just before we left, we saw something one in a rowboat, Josh said. I think it was coming to the island, but then he turned around and left.
Officer Fallon sat up.
Did you get a good look at him?
He asked. It was too foggy, Ding said.
Officer Fallon frowned and nodded. Why would anyone keep money on Squall Island? Rishrose asked.
Why wouldn't they just keep it in a regular bank?
Officer Fallon looked at Rishrose. Because it's not real money, he said.
It's not? Rishrose asked. What is it then?
I guess there's no reason not to tell you, Officer Fallon said. After you left yesterday, I remembered something I read a few weeks ago about counterfeit money. I took a closer look at the bill you found.
He pulled the envelope from his drawer and removed the $100 bill.
This is counterfeit, kid, and I'm guessing the money in your cement safe is counterfeit too.
Counterfeit? Josh gasped. You mean it's all fake? Officer Fallon smiled.
Sorry, Josh.
But who put it there? Ding asked.
That's what we're trying to find out, Officer Fallon said.
He stood and walked into the kit to the door.
Officer Keen and I will go out there for a look today. Starting now, we'll be keeping an eye on that island.
Officer Fallon opened the office door.
Off you go now, and promise me you'll stay away from that island. Counterfeiters can be dangerous.
The kid thanked Officer Fallon and left. As they walked up Main Street, Ding thought about the mysterious figure he'd seen in the boat. Was it the counterfeiter? Had he seen the three of them standing on the beach? Ding swallowed. Were he and Josh and Rose in danger?
Chapter 7.
Josh scratched his knee, then he snapped, then his left elbow.
Guess I better buy some calamine lotion, he said.
We're almost at the supermarket, Ding said. He glanced over his shoulder.
What you're looking at? Rishrose asked.
Ding shrugged. Nothing, I guess. I just keep thinking about that creepy guy in the boat.
Do you think he recognizes us?
Josh asked. I mean, if we couldn't see his face, maybe he couldn't see ours.
I hope you're right, Ding said. If the guy in the boat was the counterfeiter, he could be anyone, even someone we know.
Oh, great, Dingus, Josh said. Now I'm going to have that nightmares.
The kid walked into the supermarket and headed for the pharmacy. Mrs. Hernandez looked up and smiled.
Hi, kid. What do you need? She asked.
Josh scratched his knee. "Do you have any calamine lotion?" he asked. Mrs. Hernandez came out from behind her counter. She gave Josh a once-over. "That's potion ivy, all right," she said. She took a pink bottle from a shelf and handed it to Josh. "That's my last bottle. Ron Pinkowski came in yesterday and bought up my other drink." Josh paid Mrs. Hernandez and thanked her. Then the kid left the store. They sat on a bench while Josh dabbed Solomon lotion on his itchy spot. "I wonder why Mr. P needs this stuff," Rosro said. "Didn't he tell us he stays away from poison ivy?" "He wasn't scratching when you saw him yesterday," Ding said. Suddenly, Josh jumped up to his feet. "Oh my gosh, it's him!" Ding looked around. "Who's him?" "Mr. Pinkowski," Josh said. "He bought the Solomon lotion because he's got poison ivy, and he's got poison ivy because he was on Squall Island hiding his counterfeit money. Ding shook his head. "If Mr. P has poison ivy, he could gotten it anywhere. Maybe he's hiding a printing press in one of his empty fish tanks," Josh said.
"Josh, what are you talking about?" Rich Rose asked.
"It's perfect," Josh said. "He sells bait to fool people, but he's really getting rich, maybe making phony money."
"That's crazy," Ding said. "Just because Mr. P bought Solomon lotion doesn't mean he's counterfeiter."
Josh screwed the bottle tap on and shoved the lotion into a pocket. "I'm not crazy," he said. "He's tall, so he's probably got big feet, right?"
Ruth Rose opened her mouth, but Josh cut her off. "And he lived right on the river," Josh went on. "He's got boats. He knows Squall Island is the perfect place to stash money. It has to be him."
Ding looked at Ruth Rose. "What do you think?" he asked her.
"It could have been Mr. Pinkowski in the boat," Ruth Rose said. "But he's our friend. I can't believe he's a counterfeiter."
"I can't either," Ding said. "Well, I can," Josh said. He scratched his stomach. "Let's go back to the bait shop and see if he was poison ivy."
"But how will we know?" Ruth Rose asked.
Josh grinned. "He bought 3 bottles of Solomon lotion," he reminded her. "He'll be pink." Ding laughed. "Okay, let's go back to the bait shop," he said. "You'll look for poison ivy. I want to see if Mr. P's feet are as big as those footprints."
Chapter 8.
"Well, you were right about one thing," Riff Rose whispered to Josh. "Mr. Pinkowski does have big feet."
"Yeah, but they still don't look as big as those footprints we saw," Ding whispered back.
The kids were hiding behind the bushes near Ron's bait shop. Ron was standing in his yard, rubbing a cloth over a small green rowboat.
"Look at that. Look at that boat," Josh said. "It could be the one we saw out at the island."
"But I didn't see any Solomon lotion on him," Ding said, "and he's not scratching."
Just then a black car pulled into the driveway. Ron waved as a man in a dark suit stepped out of the car. The man waved back, then leaned into the car and pulled out a box. On its side were written 4 words, "Happy Heart Dog Food." Josh gasped. "Do you see?" "Shh," whispered Ruth Rose. The kid watched as the man handed Ron the box. Ron turned and carried it into a shed. When Ron came out, he handed the box back to the stranger. The man put it on the seat of his car, then took out a checkbook. Quickly, he scribbled out a check and handed it to Ron. Finally, he climbed back in his car and drove away.
"Check out the license plate," Rishro said.
Ding read the plate. "B-E-N-T, Bent? What that mean?" he asked.
"Who cares?" Josh said. "Mr. P just sold that guy a box full of counterfeit money. Let's go tell Officer Fallon."
"Josh, that box could have been full of dog food," Ding said.
"Dinkus, Ding," Josh said. "Someone had fake money in those same dog food boxes on Squall Island. I see one of those 2 guys in the counterfeiter."
"Josh could be right," Ruth Rose pointed out. "But before we go see Officer Fallon, maybe we can find out who this other man is."
"How?" Ding asked.
"Let's ask at the gas station," Ruth Rose said. Mr. Holly might know who drives a black car with Bent on the license plate."
When the kid reached the gas station, Mr. Holly was nowhere in sight. Then Ding heard someone whistling. The tune was coming from under a banged-up red pickup truck.
"Mr. Holly," Ding said, "is that you?"
A round, gray, smudged face popped out from under the truck.
"Howdy," Mr. Holly said, grinning. All the kids, "you got car trouble?"
"Sort of,"
Retro said. Do you know who owns the car with Bent on the license plate?
Mr. Holly stood up and wiped his hand on the rack. Why is the car bent? He said, winking at Dink. Dink laughed. Oh no,
but we need to find the driver, he said. I found some money, Retro said. We think it might be his.
Sound like those new folks, Mr. Holly said. Mr. and Mrs. Warden Bent. A few weeks ago, they rented a small house on Fox Lane. I put a set of Fox plugs in that snazzy Lincoln on theirs.
Fox Lane, Dink said, giving Josh a look. That's over by the river.
Righto, Mr. Holly said. Nice view of the water. Now, if you'll excuse me, this old truck needs my help.
The kid thanked Mr. Holly and left the gas station. We know who the guy is now, Dink said, but we still can prove you or Mr. P is a counterfeiter.
But the box, Josh started to say, we don't know what was in it, Dink reminded him.
Right, Retro said. Why don't we go to Mr. Bent's house and wait for him to come home? Maybe we can get a peek at the box when he goes in his house.
Okay, but let's be careful, Dink said. I don't want to end up locked in that vault on Squall Island.
Chapter 9. The kid crossed Thistle Court and headed toward Fox Lane. There were only three small houses on the narrow lane. The last one was a cottage nearly hidden in trees and thick bushes. Somewhere, a bird let out a single chirp. Josh nudged Dink. The car, he whispered, pointing. The same black car was parked under a tree. The license plate was bent. The kid snuck up to the car. All three peered through a rear window. There was no Happy Heart dog food box on the car seat on floor. He must have taken it into the house, Dink said, crouching down next to Josh and Ruth Rose.
Now, what do we do? Josh asked.
We could try getting inside the house, Ruth Rose said. Josh looked at her. How? What if we ring the bell and say we're selling Girl Scout cookies?
Josh rolled his eyes. Yeah, right, two boys selling Girl Scout cookies.
Okay then, I'll do it alone, Retro said.
No way, Dink said. No one's getting into that house. If the bent or the counterfeiters, they're dangerous. So what do we do? Josh asked. I sure could use a sandwich.
Suddenly, the front door opened. A short-legged hound dog with floppy ears waddled out onto the porch. The dog was brown and white with big, sad eyes.
Stay here, the house, shorty, a voice said. Uh-oh, Josh whispered.
Let's get out of here before he smells us, Retro said. The cat melted up into the thick shrubbery growing wild on both sides of the cottage. They crept towards the backyard, trying to be as quiet as possible.
Look, Dink said, pointing to a small garage at the next back up at the property. Except for the door, the garage was surrounded by bushes.
We can hide there. Just then the dog let out a howl. Retro looked over her shoulder. Oh no, he's after us.
The kid sprinted behind the garage. Dink found a low window. I'm here, in here, he said, shoving the window sash up.
The dog came lopping around the corner with an eye to the ground. Nice doggy, Josh whispered. The hound looked at Josh and let out another howl.
Quick, inside, Dink said. He drove through the open window.
Josh and Riffles piled into the garage on top of Dink. Outside, the dog started barking. Dink saw a black snout and eyes peeking over the sill. He shoved Josh off him and closed the window. The dog was still barking. It scratched at the window with its big feet.
We have to hide, Dink said. The bent are bound to hear all that noise.
The kids quickly looked around. Against one wall, a workbench was piled with junk. Dink noticed a tarp-covered mound opposite the bench. Josh and Rose dove under the bench. Dink headed for the tarp. He lifted one edge, crawled underneath, and let the tarp droop over his back. It was dark under the tarp. Dink couldn't see a thing. He found himself sprawled on top of several hard boxes with sharp edges. Suddenly, the dog stopped barking. Dink thought he heard a human voice. He lifted a corner of the tarp and peeked toward the window. Through the dirty glass, Dink saw a woman's leg. She bent down, picked up the dog, and carried him out of sight. Barely breathing, Dink waited until he felt sure the woman wasn't coming back. Then, he crawled out from under the tarp. On the other side of the garage, Josh and Rose came out from under the bench.
That was close, Rufro said.
Dink looked around. They were standing on the cement floor. The air was cool and dry. In one corner stood
gardening tools and a few fishing poles. Then Ding spotted something. "Look," he said. On top of the workbench sat a Happy Heart dog food box. "Maybe it's the one Mr. Bent had in his car," Ding said. Yang opened the box flap. Inside, he found only a pink can with green smears on its side. Ding thought for a minute. "Guys, remember that boat Mr. P was working on? It was green, right?" He held up the paint can. "Maybe the boat belonged to Mr. Bent, and Ron painted it for him. This could be the leftover paint." Then, the check Mr. Bent gave him was to pay for the paint job, Retro said. She reached into the box and pulled out a wetted ball of paper. She flattened it on the workbench. "It's a receipt from the Paranasi," Retro said, "for 3 bottles of Salmon lotion." Ding stared at the recipe. It was from a credit card. Neatly printed on the bottom of the pieces of paper was the name Ronald W. Pinkowski. "Hey guys, check this out." Josh had been poking around the other side of the garage. Hanging on the wall, pegs were 2 pairs of long green wading boots. Josh unhooked one pair and took it down. "Look at the side of this foot," he said. Dink walked over for a closer look. "These must be what made those big footprints," he said. Rich Rose examined the bottom of one of the foot, wedged into the tread were tiny pebbles and sand. The kids stared at each other. "Now what do we do?" Josh asked. "Now we go tell Officer Fallon what we found," Ding said. He tiptoed over to the garage door and peeked through a crack. "Uh-oh," Ding said. "We're in trouble, guys. Mrs. Ben just bought out some food. She's lining the grill." "Great," Josh muttered. "And I'm stuck. I'm in here, starving to death." He and Rich Rose joined Ding at the crack. "Look," Rich Rose said. A tall man walked up to the grill. It was the man they seen at Ron's big shop, but now he was wearing shorts and a t-shirt. His long arm and legs were bludged with Calamine lotion. Chapter 10. Rich Rose let out a small gasp. "He's the one who got poison ivy on Squall Island. The Calamine lotion was for him." But Mr. Pinkowski bought it," Josh said. "I still see there's in it together." Ding peeked through the garage door crack again. "Mr. Bent reading a newspaper," he whispered. Mrs. Bent cooking hamburger." "Is the dog there?" Josh asked.
"Yep. If we try to leave the dog, we'll probably start barking again," Retro said.
"Those hamburgers smell so good," Josh said. He let out a little groan. "Don't think about food," Ding said. "Think about a way to get us out of here."
"Okay, I will," Josh said. He shoved Dink aside and put an eye to the crack.
"I have a plan," he said after a minute.
"Tell us," Rich Rose said.
Josh grinned. "Let's invite the Bent into the garage."
Rich Rose shook her head. "The poison ivy has finally gotten to his brain," she said to Dink.
"No, listen," Josh said. "We'll make a lot of noise. The Bent and Pooch will hear it. They'll come flying in here to find out what's going on and catch us in their garage," Ding interrupted.
Josh smiled officially. "No, because we'll be hopping out the window. They'll never see us."
Ding nodded thoughtfully.
"It could work," he said, "but I think we need to figure out a way to keep them in here long enough for us to get away."
"I have an idea," Rich Rose walked over to the workbench.
"There must be something to write with," she murmured.
"What are you going to write?" Josh asked.
"Uh-huh," Rich Rose pulled a hunk of carpenter chalk out of the toolbox. She kneeled on the floor and printed in large letters.
"I know about your counterfeit money. Let's talk or I go to the cops. Meet me on Squall Island in an hour."
"Oh my gosh," Josh yelped. "But what if they just go out to the island, take the money, and leave town?" Dink asked.
"Exactly. When they do, Officer Fallon will be waiting for them," Rich Rose said.
Josh found a hammer in the toolbox. "Find me something to bang on," he told Dink. "Then get ready to move."
"I'll keep an eye outside," Rich Rose said, heading for the garage door. Dink glanced around the garage, then walked over to the tarp he hidden under. He yanked the tarp away and let out a low whistle.
"Guys, look!" Josh and Rich Rose hurried over. Dink had uncovered 4 Happy Heart dog food boxes. Dink tore open one flap and peeked inside. "Just cans of dog food," he said.
"He must use some empty boxes to carry the fake money," said Rich Rose. Josh spotted an empty pail. "I bet I can get their attention with this," he said. Dink opened a window. Rich Rose came over to stand beside him.
"Okay, Josh," Dink said, "do it."
Josh took a deep breath, then started pounding the bottom of the pail with the hammer. The noise boomed through the garage like thunder. "Now," Josh said. He dropped the hammer and pail and bolted for the window. The kid hopped out and crouched in the weeds. A few minutes later, they heard the garage door creak open and Mr. Ben say, "Stay, Shorty," then they heard Mrs. Ben say, "Warden, someone's been in here. Something's written on the floor." That was all the kid needed to hear. He raced toward the trees on the other side of the house. In 2 minutes, they had crossed the high school playing field and were heading down Main Street. "I sure hope Officer Fallon is in," Ding said. Out of breath, he was. The kid burst through the door with red faces. Officer Fallon looked up.
"What are you?"
"We found the counterfeiter," all three kids yelled. Chapter 11. Interrupting each other, the kid told Officer Fallon about the band. Even before Officer Fallon heard about the happy hard dog food boxes, he was shouting orders into his telephone. "Don't go back to Fox Lane," were his last word before he leaped for the door and disappeared. "Now what?" Ding asked. Why shall we be left out?" Rose asked. "Let's go watch."
"Go where?" Josh asked.
"He said to stay away." "Not Fox Lane," Dink interrupted. "The action is gonna be on Squall Island." Minutes later, they were catching their breath next to Officer Fallon's cruiser on Riverboat. The fog had lifted and they had a better view of Squall Island. Dink peered across the river, but saw only sand and rocks. Out of breath, Josh sank to the ground. "I think I'm having a heart attack," he moaned. "Do you think Officer Fallon is out there?" Rose asked. "Grinning, I don't see anyone." The kid sat in the shade of the cruiser and watched the island. Suddenly, Josh jumped to his feet. "Dear devourer," he shouted. Three figures had come around the island to other side. It was too far away to tell who they were, but Ding thought he could see Officer Fallon's dark uniform. Then the fourth person came into a view. He was pulling a small, flat-bottom boat behind him. "And Officer Fallon and Officer Keene," Ding said. "They got the band." The kid watched the group come closer. The water was nearly up to Officer Fallon's knees. He led the band, who were handcuffed. Officer Keene waited behind pulling the boat. It was green.
"No, what's in the boat?" Josh said. "It piled with money and dog food boxes."
Nobody spoke as Officer Fallon led the two counterfeiters to shore. The band were wearing their long wading boots. Their faces were angry as they stumbled up the riverbank. Officer King pulled the boat ashore and loaded the counterfeit money into the trunk of the cruiser. Officer Fallon opened the rear door for the band, then locked it once they were inside.
"Good job," he said to the kids. He looked at Josh. "Are you folks home?"
"I don't know," Josh answered. "Meet me at your house in an hour," Officer Fallon said. Then he and Officer King hitched up their wet pants and climbed into the cruiser. The car speeded away, leaving the airfield with dust and spine needle.
"Why does Officer Fallon want to talk to your mom and dad?" Ding asked, grinning. "Are you in trouble?"
"Gee, I wonder what jail food is like," Retro said. Ding patted Josh's belly. "I heard they feed the prisoners worm waffles for breakfast." "Tee hee," Josh said. "You guys are so funny, you probably want to give me a reward for catching the band."
"You didn't catch them," Rifro said. "The three of us did. But we all know I'm the brains in this group," Josh said, smiling.
They cut through a field to get to Josh's house. Josh yanked open the back door and yelled, "Anybody home?" No one answered. "Let's eat," Josh said. "I make some sandwiches." They sat in Josh's backyard into jelly sandwiches, paper cups, and a counter of milk.
"I wonder where the band make the money," Ding said. "Do you suppose they have a printing machine in that house?"
Josh put his sandwich down. "What will it be like to make money whenever you want it?" Ding heard a car roll into Josh's driveway. A door slammed and Officer Fallon came around the house.
"Can you spare some of that milk?" he asked Josh.
"Sure," Josh filled a cup and handed it to Officer Fallon. He took a long sip, then looked at the kit. "The band are locked up, but they're not talking. When they do, I expect we'll find out they were just the middle guys. Whoever is printing all those 100 is still out there somewhere."
But why did the bandits hide their money on Squall Island? Josh asked.
Easy to get up to, Officer Fallon said. With their boat at the beach stop, they should get out to the island in a few minutes.
At first, we thought they might be partners with Mr. Pankowski, Ding said.
Officer Fallon nodded. I can see why you thought so. I talked to Ron. He kept their boat in this yard. Then after Ben saw you kids on the island, he asked Ron to paint it. I guess he was afraid you would recognize it if you ever saw it again.
Why did Mr. Pankowski buy the calamine lotion? Josh asked.
Ron's a nice guy, Officer Fallon said. I guess he noticed Ben was itching, so we thought he bought him the lotion as a favor.
Officer Fallon glanced at Josh's barn. Keep any animals in there? He asked Josh.
No, Josh said. The twins and I want a pony, but Dad says there's too much work.
How about a dog? Officer Fallon said. I just happen to have a nice, friendly Basset hound who needs a good home.
Josh's eyes lit up. Really? Officer Fallon smiled. Maybe you two shall get to know each other. He whispered.
Around the corner, jogged Officer King, leading a short-legged dog with droopy ears.
It's Shorty, Riffro said.
You kid already know this pooch? Officer Fallon said.
He was at the band's house, Dink explained. He almost gave away our hiding place.
Officer Fallon stroked the dog's velvety ears. Well, his owner are going to prison for a long time. He needs a new home.
Josh kneeled down and patted the dog's silky coat.
Hey, doggy, said, you want to leave here? The dog gave Josh a lick with his long pink tongue, then plopped to the ground and rolled over.
He likes me, Josh said.
I was counting on it, Officer Fallon said. He dropped the leash into Josh's hands and leaped for his car. Have your folks call me, he said as he left.
Thanks, Officer Fallon, Josh called. What shall we name him? Josh asked after a minute.
He already has a name, Ruth reminded Josh.
Shorty. Josh shook his head. There's a terrible name if you were short. Would you want to be called Shorty?
Josh is right, Dink said. We can come up with a better name with that.
But when Josh's parents came home an hour later, the kids still hadn't picked a name. When Josh finally got permission to keep the dog, he still had no name. Later that night, Dink, Josh, and Rich Rose drifted off to sleep in their bathroom. The short-legged dog with droopy ears snorted at the end of Josh's bed, but he still had no name.
Thank you for listening to my channel. Bye-bye for now. We'll see you tomorrow. Bye-bye.